Καλησπέρα σε όλους. Δύο κουβεντούλες πολύ σύντομα να πω για το σύλλογό μας, για όσους δεν μας γνωρίζουν, για όσους έρχονται για πρώτη φορά εδώ. Και μετά βέβαια θα παραχωρήσω το βήμα στον Ιτέρο Λινιόρ, τον εκλεκτό προσκεκλημένο μας τον Απόψινό. Όπως βλέπετε και από δίπλα εδώ, ο πλήρης τίτλος του συλλόγου, της οργάνωσής μας, η Ένωση Ελλήνων Χριστών και Φίλων ΕΛΑΚ, για συντομία Greek Look. Είμαστε μια μη κυβερνητική οργάνωση, η οποία ασχολούμαστε με το ελεύθερο λογισμικό, το οποίο βλέπετε το μικρό λογότυπο αριστερά και το λογισμικό ανοιχτού κώδικα με το μικρό του Κιγουινάκο που βλέπετε το λογότυπο στα δεξιά. Πρόκειται για μια μη κυβερνητική οργάνωση. Ασχολούμαστε οπωσδήποτε με ό,τι σχετίζεται με το ελεύθερο λογισμικό, αλλά και με τα ανοιχτά πρότυπα, που είναι μια στενά συνδεδεμένη υπόθεση. Στόχος μας βέβαια είναι η μετάδοση της γνώσης προς τους ανθρώπους για την ελευθερία που θα πρέπει να έχει ο καθένας στην επιλογή των λογισμικών που χρησιμοποιεί στον υπολογιστή του. Διοργανώνουμε συνεχώς διάφορες δράσεις έξω προς τον κόσμο, προς την κοινωνία, μαθήματα εσωτερικά εδώ στο Σύλλογο για επίδειξη διάφορων λογισμικών ή και διανομών, ποικιλιών δηλαδή του λειτουργικού συστήματος, παρουσιάσεις για διάφορα πράγματα, που φυσικά μπορείτε να παρακολουθήσετε ο καθένας και να συμμετάσχει όπου θέλει. Εδώ στην που είναι η έδρα μας υπάρχει και το εργαστήριο αυτό με τους υπολογιστές που βλέπετε, όπου ο καθένας είναι στημένος και από μια διαφορετική εκδοχή του λειτουργικού συστήματος GNU Linux για να μπορεί οποιοδήποτε να δοκιμάσει στην πραγματικότητα τι θα πει αυτό, τι χρώμα έχει, πώς λειτουργεί και τι διαφορές έχει σε σχέση με το όποιο άλλο λειτουργικό σύστημα που ίσως έχετε στους υπολογιστές σας. Το εργαστήριο και η ίδια η έδρα του Συλλόγου είναι εδώ σε αυτό το σημείο όπου βρίσκεστε τώρα. Η ιστοσελίδα μας είναι το www.greekloop.gr και το email μας για τις πληροφορίες είναι το info@greekloop.gr. Για όσους δεν μας γνωρίζετε, αν θέλετε να ασχοληθείτε λίγο παραπάνω, να καταλάβετε κάτι παραπάνω από την πληροφορική τους υπολογιστές, τα λογισμικά και ιδιαίτερα το ελεύθερο λογισμικό, μπορείτε να μιλήσετε με οποιονδήποτε από τα μέλη εδώ του Συλλόγου για να εγγραφείτε όποιος θέλει, θα είναι χαρά μας και τιμή μας. Οι συνεργάτες που έχουμε είναι μια σειρά από διεθνείς συνεργασίες που έχουμε αναπτύξει μέχρι τώρα. Τις θέτουμε κατά σειρά χρονολογική και όχι αξιολόγησης, ας πούμε. Καταρχάς, γίνανε συνδεδεμένους οργανισμούς με το Ευρωπαϊκό Ίδρυμα Ελεύθερου Λογισμικού, το Free Software Foundation of Europe, με το Linux Professional Institute LPI, το οποίο είμαστε και Master Affiliate ως οργανισμός. Με την FTA Free Technology Academy, είναι ένας οργανισμός που προσφέρει μαθήματα εξ αποστάσεως από ηλεκτρονική πλατφόρμα. Πρόκειται για ένα συνασπισμό πανεπιστημίων. Έχει διάφορα εξαιρετικά βιβλία σε ηλεκτρονική μορφή PDF, τα οποία μπορεί ο καθένας να κατεβάσει ελεύθερα, διότι κυκλοφορούν με ειδικές άδειες, σε ελεύθερο περιεχομένο και όχι με το κλασικό copyright που είναι τα βιβλία. Κάποια από αυτά τα φιλοξενούμε και στο site του Συλλόγου, στον κύκλο εκπαίδευση. Υπάρχει μια κουκουβάγια έτσι πάνω δεξιά, ένα πιγουινάκι που λέει για εκπαίδευση. Μπορείτε από εκεί να μπείτε και να δείτε κάποια από τα βιβλία τα οποία έχουν και φιλοξενούμε και έχουν μεταφράσει κάποια από αυτά στα ελληνικά. Και τέλος, μια από τις τελευταίες συνεργασίες ήταν και η συνεργασία με τον Δήμο Πουλέα Σκορπιάτη, με τον οποίο έχουμε αναπτύξει μια πολύπλευρη δραστηριότητα προσφοράς εθελοντικών υπηρεσιών προς τα σχολεία, προς τον ίδιο το Δήμο, προς τους υπαλλήλους του Δήμου, προς τους δημότες κτλ. Εάν κάποια ώρα παρεμπιπτόντως δεν υπήρχε αυτός ο κόσμος εδώ απόψε, θα ήταν γεμάτο με παιδιά και νέους που έρχονται να δοκιμάσουν το ελεύθερο λογισμικό, να κάνουν browsing, να δουν τι κάνουν αυτά τα μηχανήματα, τι είναι αυτό το κάτι άλλο που δεν είναι Windows και είναι GNU Linux κτλ. Αυτά, νομίζω ότι δεν έχω κάτι άλλο να πω. Μία κουβέντα, αν και για όσους είναι ήδη μέλη μας, δεν χρειάζεται να πω πολλά για τον Ιτέρο Λινιόρ, είναι ένας πολύ γνωστός άνθρωπος, πολύ προβεβλημένος άνθρωπος. Αν θα πω κάτι, το λέω κυρίως για αυτούς που δεν τον γνωρίζετε. Έχει εδώ και πολλά χρόνια αναμειχθεί ενεργά με την υπόθεση του ελεύθερου λογισμικού και συγκεκριμένα ενός ιδιαίτερου προγράμματος που είναι το LibreOffice. Όσοι από εσάς δουλεύετε σε περιβάλλον Windows, που μάλλον θα είστε αρκετοί, ό,τι είναι για εσάς ίσως το Office της Microsoft, είναι το αντίστοιχο στον κόσμο του ελεύθερου λογισμικού, είναι το LibreOffice. Ο οργανισμός ο οποίος το διαχειρίζεται και το μαντάρει κατά κάποιο τρόπο είναι το The Document Foundation, είναι μια ΜΚΟ που βρίσκεται από πίσω, η οποία έχει σαν έδρα τη Γερμανία. Και της οποίας στο Διοικητικό Συμβούλιο είναι ο Ιταλο Μινιόλι και είναι και ο υπεύθυνος, ο διευθυντής των δημοσίων και διεθνών σχέσεων του ίδιου του LibreOffice. Χαρά μας είναι και τιμή μας είναι που ήρθε να μιλήσουμε και από κοντά. Θέλησε να μας κάνει και μια μικρή παρουσίαση, να μας μιλήσει ευρύτερα για τις δραστηριότητες του The Document Foundation και για το πώς χτίζεται αυτό το πράγμα που απολαμβάνουμε όσοι χρησιμοποιούμε το LibreOffice. Και βέβαια θα έχουμε ξανά τη χαρά να τον ξαναδούμε την Πέμπτη το βράδυ στην Καλάνδρα, στην Πανεπιστημιακή Κατασκήνωση, όπου θα είναι και βασικός ομιλητής της προσυνεδριακής ημερίδας. Απόψε βέβαια είναι μια ομιλία που θα έχει ένα διαφορετικό χρώμα από την μεθαυριανή, δεν θα είναι το ίδιο πράγμα. Όσοι καταφέρετε, το λέω, θα χαρείτε να δείτε και κάτι διαφορετικό και μια άλλη εκδοχή. Απόψε επίσης θα είναι κάτι διαφορετικό. Όσοι παλιόχοι, τουλάχιστον τον είδατε και τον απολαύσετε μια φορά. Ευχαριστώ πολύ. Ήθελα να το concedo il passo. Mi permetto di fare l'interprete di me stesso, quindi se c'è qualche cosa sto qui di lato, traduco se c'è bisogno.
Ok. Good afternoon to everybody. Sorry for speaking in English. Greek is a niche language like Italian, and I only know a few words. But I've been to Greece quite a few times. You see, that this is 30 years ago, and sorry for the Calimera, but it's that was copied and pasted from Google. This is me exactly 30 years ago in front of the Parthenon in Athene with my wife. And I'm not a developer. I'm being one of the founders of the Document Foundation. Yanad means I'm not a developer. Although I'm not a developer, I have 6 commits on the help file. By the way, this is my avatar, and I was explaining to Kostas before, the original avatar was without the holy circle, but I was born in Assisi, the city of St. Francis, and then the holy circle happened on my avatar just by miracle. So it's something, because I'm a real saint. Anyway, what I'm going to tell you, or what I'm going to speak to you about, is a kind of journey that we are doing, the journey started in the reality 12 years ago. 12 years ago, when something happened in the free software movement, and when Sun decided to open source the suite that they had just bought, that was StarOffice, they decided to open source it, and with the name of OpenOffice. Sun leading the project was a very good fact for the first few years, because of course at the time, we are talking about 12 years ago, at the time the free software community was very young in general. There were not many software competing with the proprietary software. Of course, if you look at the operating system, GNU Linux is older, but the commercial viability of GNU Linux is in the last 10 years, when the distribution started to be more user-friendly and more accessible to the user. So 12 years ago, it was kind of a dream to have a free software productivity suite that was competing with Microsoft Office. At the time, Microsoft Office had more than 95% of the market, which means almost a monopoly. At the time, the only two competitors were IBM Smart Suite, coming from Lotus, and Corel WordPerfect Suite, coming from WordPerfect and then bought by Corel in Canada. So we were this way, and we have been this way for a number of years, when Sun was leading the project, because there was basically no community. The community started in France from three guys. One is Frank Capra, which has disappeared. He is now looking after other stuff. A lady, Sophie Gauthier, she's with LibreOffice and with the Document Foundation today, and a very young man at the time, Charles Schulz, who is again one of the members of the board of directors of the Document Foundation. And it started like a kind of a bet, because there was no community worldwide, there was no people knowledgeable about free software. And we can say that for 5-6 years, it was the fact that Sun led the project was a very positive fact. And we came, that was the situation in 2000. So when we started, these people knowledgeable about software, these are the big dependencies of StarOffice 5.2 in the year 2000. You can see it was a lean software, not many dependencies. It was easy to understand. Developers could get up to speed probably in a couple of months, a good developer. Then what happened? That of course, adding features, adding modules, the software started to become a little bit bloated, a little bit heavy. So in 2005, this was the OpenOffice of 2005. And at that time, in 2005, I actually started to be part of the community in 2004. In 2005, we had a meeting at the conference in Koper, Capodistria, which is a small city in Slovenia close to the Italian border. And we started discussing, not in the official tracks, but just in front of a beer, about the fact that having one single company leading the project was starting to be a limit. Not because the company was intrinsically bad, Sun did a hell of a good job, but because the company wanted to follow his own path. And like myself, there were people, another one, Olivier Allo in Brazil, is a French name, but he has a French name, but was born in Brazil. He was an executive at Oracle, and it was an executive at IBM, and he started to follow the free software. So Olivier brought a lot of management experience, I brought a lot of marketing experience, and other people in other areas started to bring in quite a deep experience in other fields. So the community that was originally a developer community started to be a wider and a more complex community, with people able to discuss with Sun about marketing, about management, about, and we started to realize that Sun, and actually I have been an executive at Honeywell Information System in the early 80s, so in a large US corporation, and I can understand that a corporation in a sense doesn't like the community, because the community, if it has a strong voice, can be a nuisance for the corporation, because the corporation wants to follow its own development path. So Sun had his own objectives, and the community started to have a different kind of objectives that in some cases were overlapping, but in others were not overlapping. So at that time, we pushed so hard with Sun that in 2006 at the Lyon conference, this is a Sun presentation. So actually this presentation was made by Michael Bemmer, who was the leader, the manager of the entire OpenOffice business unit at Sun. And he started to write reduction of code complexity, because we, the community, started to say, look, the code is too complex. Localizing it starts to be a problem. Solving problems when you are not involved in a core code development, it starts to be a problem. We want to have a kind of a leaner or a more agile software. But what happened is that we asked, and they made a nice presentation, but then nothing happened. And then, you know, What happened afterwards, Sun was sold to Oracle, and then we decided to fork as the community. So we decided to leave OpenOffice and found LibreOffice. And this is just one of the examples of what we have achieved in 2 years in terms of code cleaning, what we were meaning in 2006 and was not done until 2010. So of course, from 2006 to 2010, the code was additionally becoming more complex. But these are unused methods. So this means that there were something between 5,000 and 6,000 useless processes in the code. And we are now close to zero. Of course, this is the toughest part. This is really difficult. But you can understand this is between June 11 and June 12. So in 1 year of cleaning the code. This means that we got rid of unused libraries, we got rid of code that was there but was not used, code that made the suite slower when starting, that made the suite more complex to look at. Also, another OpenOffice was developed in Germany, and actually the project started in 1984 with a word processor for CPM, for the Commodore system. Then was then ported to Windows, then to Linux, to Solaris, and so on. The software was completely developed in Hamburg, and it didn't start as an international software, so comments were written in German. And although we have a full respect to German people, their language is just slightly more used worldwide than Italian and Greek, but it's not as used as English or any or other languages. So we decided to make the software really international by getting rid of German comments, and actually my commits are on the help and is about getting rid of useless comments. And I got rid of comments like comment, I don't understand what does it mean, close comment. Which means that if he doesn't understand and if just useless to comment saying that is you don't understand, because you don't say what you don't understand, you just say that you don't understand at all. Which means at that line, either there is a developer that comes in and explains it, or the comment is useless. The problem is that all these comments are code that it has to be loaded at load time and has to be maintained, and is also creating dependencies. So the awful lot of dependencies that I've shown before is even added by the fact that there is useless code inside. So the basic idea we started was not just to fork because we didn't like the government, was to fork because we wanted to have a different evolution path for the suite. We did, because people said you it's like you did something like a strike against Oracle. Of course, we were not pleased by the Oracle government, and it was clear to the internals that Oracle would drop the development, which then happened really in 2011. But the reality is that we didn't want to go against Oracle. We wanted to go to give to the users a better product with an evolution path that was going in a different direction, because we wanted to have the same code running on tablets, for instance, or the same code running on the cloud, something that was totally impossible with the OpenOffice code, and is now starts to be possible with LibreOffice. You probably, if you have followed the evolution of the project, you've seen that we already have a prototype of the cloud version, and we have a prototype of the Android version that is probably going to be released sometimes next year, but is you can understand looking at the software that is available on Android, for instance, or at the online solutions of online software suite like Office so-called 365, reality 364, because the server was out for one day. These are not full feature software. They are a cut version of the software, because having the same code running online from a server in the cloud and on a desktop is not a trivial task. So we are close to having it working and to have it working in a proper way. And this is because we cleaned the code and we made the code more manageable. And still, this is not finished. Much of the activity that today is done behind the curtains, because you see only new features, and I will show you new features. But behind new features, there is an increasing number of developers that is working on the infrastructure, on testing, on improving quality assurance, and on making the software easier to maintain and easier to hack for the hackers that are coming to the project. So, what we have done basically, this this slide shows very well the operation that we have done. This is the Sun or Oracle situation, where you have a company that makes the umbrella, so the company is like protecting the project, but it's also limiting the project in a way, because if you get away from the umbrella, then you get wet by getting the rain. And we have just turned the umbrella upside down, and we have made it a kind of mixing bowl, which means that, and if you prefer, as we are on the seaside, you can see that as a boat, where if everyone helps, then the boat follows the good line. If people is not helping, then the boat goes on its own. So it's really a project where everyone is able to give his own contribution and to help and grow the project and to help and make the project better day after day. Small contributions are as welcome as big ones, just because this is a real free software project. It's a real software project where developers talk with marketing people talk to localizer talk to quality assurance people, and all the people around. So it's not a project where you have the developers who are separated from the rest of the world, because the developers are leaded or managed by a single company. This is the developers talking with the rest of the project and trying to do the best for the user. Because at the end, all of us are users of the software. And we want a better software because we like to have a better software and to use a better software. So what happened is that the community, when we forked and we switched from the OpenOffice and we launched the Document Foundation, the reality is that the majority of the community followed the Document Foundation because they share our values. And we launch and we announce LibreOffice. Many people have asked why LibreOffice and not another name. The answer is easy. Out of 392 options that we examined, LibreOffice was the single one that was not registered in any market. FreeOffice was registered as a registered trademark in 111 countries. So choosing FreeOffice means that on the day after, you have 111 lawyers out of your door asking for money, which is something that we didn't want. So of course LibreOffice is not the best name in terms of it's very good for Italians, for instance. It's probably, I don't know if it is good, it's fantastic for French people, it's very good for Spanish, it's awkward for Germans, it's not as good for Americans that you don't, they don't understand how to say Libre, but anyway. This is the reason why we found the shortened Libo, which is easier to say in each language. Anyway, LibreOffice, these are the icons. It's based on volunteers, and volunteers are very welcome. So if you might become a volunteer just by doing a very tiny action, like finding a bug, or helping someone on a mail, on the user mailing list, I kindly invite you to do that, because this is the spirit of the community. This is a really democratic and meritocratic community. People that is recognized for what they do. We have a reference point for each project. We don't have leaders because we don't like the fact of having a structure or a hierarchy. If you do, you are welcomed, you are appreciated, and we like you. For instance, I am considered the point of reference for marketing and certification. We have a Gene Weber, who's Australian, for documentation. We have Kornhaus, who's Dutch, for quality assurance, together with Rainer Wielfeld, who's German, and so on. We have Sophie Gauthier for localization. It's just a real global community. We have people from everywhere. We have South Africans. We have people from the Far East. We have people from South America. It's exciting and it's fun to be a member of this community. And it's interesting because the software is growing. And it's growing thanks to our developers. We have a fantastic developer community. When we started, we had 20 developers. In fact, the 20 developers stayed as 20 developers for 25 minutes. Because we had the 21st developers committing a bug, and I'm not joking, but Norbert Yebaud from Texas is a very senior software developer, really a senior software developer. He saw the announcement, and after 21 minutes, he committed his first patch. And actually, probably not many people worldwide could do that in 20 minutes. But of course, he was already on Git. He downloaded the code, and he did an easy hack. Then he wrote a message, said, if you have something more difficult, I would be happy to help, because that is too easy for me, and I would not do a second easy hack. Easy hack are the trick that our first 20 core developers used to attract other developers, and they've done it so well that now we have over 500 people working on the code. And more or less the split, we have 50 core, which are paid by companies or volunteers. But let's say that these guys are working on a daily basis on the code. Then we have around 110 volunteers working on a weekly basis, and more or less 160, of course these are rough numbers, working on a monthly basis, committing once, let's say once a month. It's a group of different extraction. We have, these are the volunteers, these are based on the number of commits. Of course, if we didn't have companies paying people, we would not be able to provide such a professional software. So we have a very large amount of code developed by Suzy and by Red Hat. This is the amount of code developed by former Oracle people. So this used to be, in 2010, used to be more than 60% of the code. Now it's 10%. So we change 50% of that code, and we add 50% of that code to make it better. Then we have Canonical, and then we have other companies. But the fact that the other companies are a tiny fraction doesn't mean really anything, because there might be key development in that tiny 2%. And the beauty of this is that it's a diverse community. We don't rely anymore on a single company for the project. Even if tomorrow, and it will not happen, but even if tomorrow, SUSE people, all of them leave the project, we would still have that much of Red Hat, we would still have that much of volunteers, we would still have Canonical and other companies working on the code. And this is very important. Before, it was just one company providing more than 80% of the code. So it was not a community project. Because if that company would leave the code, the project would drop in one day. It was impossible for the rest of the developers to understand that part of the code. Now, in this area, we have some very senior volunteers that are working on a specific module or on infrastructure tasks which are key. Norbert Thiebaud, that I mentioned before, is now handling all the automated quality assurance tasks. We have 15 machines, 15 tinderboxes running on a daily basis and compiling the software after each commit to see if the commit breaks the software. And Norbert is administering all this amount of stuff. I can make another example. Lionel Elie Maman, and the name is Algerian, but he lives in Luxembourg. He's a senior database developer, and he's looking after base, and he's has added filters, and he's improving the quality of the filters, and he has just taken a kind of small portion of the code and is bringing the code forward. And of course, what happens if you find a senior developer looking after one module, then the history says that you will find more junior developers following him and adding patches and adding and solving bugs, because they find a natural leader of the on that area. So base, that was kind of the forgotten part of OpenOffice in the past, is now improving dramatically and becoming quite a nice component of the suite. Of course, if you listen to Lionel, it tells that it will become a good software in 10 years, because he's a very senior database developer, but the software has already made substantial progresses, because he is just taking care of it. And this is happening with other part, with filters, for instance. So it's amazing to see how, once you liberate the software for the control of a single company, that of course wanted to keep everything under his own control, it's amazing to see how the software and the development grows in a short time. And the fact that we have a balanced developers community is not just a self statement, but we have been working with a university in Sweden, especially with Björn Lundell. They are making an independent research on our community. And this was the result after 10 months, and I will be in Tunis for a conference in 3 weeks, where I will see the next result after 1 year and a half. And I'm sure that this 66% was open office, because at the time all the Sun engineers were committing with an open office email, and this is Sun. So if you 66 plus 16 is 80%, is more than 80% of the code developed by one single company, and this is what after 10 months you see the Red Hat, Oracle, still of course. These are single people. SUSE, Googleware is a company, people committing with their Gmail address, of course. The community, after 10 months, was already easy to understand that the project, that the switch that the project has made from a single company-based project to a community-based project. And this is the growth of the developers. These are the first 20 that I mentioned before. But you see, in October 2010, we had over 80 new developers joining the project. So we went from 20 to over 100 in 1 month. And now we are at over 500. This is June. If we look at July, in July we had 10 new developers coming. So this is 493. We are 503. And the last figure I looked on August 16, we had another 8 joining in August, so we are already at over 510 developers. Of course, not all of them are working on a daily basis. It is a volunteer-based project. Most of these guys are volunteers, so they are not working on a daily basis. But of course, what it's easy to understand is that if you have more than 500 people on a project, you can have an easy alternance between people that works on a day and then cannot work the day after, and another one that works the day after, and so on. So the fact is that and this shows where our Fiverr plan is going. If you look at the number of contributions per month, these months are higher because until March 2011, Oracle was still working developing OpenOffice, so we were getting their code inside LibreOffice. But when Oracle stopped, if you look at the month between April 2011 and June 2012, you see that only in June 11 and July 11 we had less than 60 people working on the code, but we went up to almost 100 in April 2012. And we are steadily over 60 on every month after the Oracle stopped working on OpenOffice. And also, this is the number of commits on a monthly basis. You see that with the exception of October 11 and May 2012, we always have more than 1,500 commits on code commit each month, which means that there is an active community working almost on a daily basis on the code. These are downloads of 3.5. This is easier to read. This is from February 13 to June 18, and the downloads are growing with every new version. So what is going to happen, the next wave will be that we will have core developers focusing specifically on bugs, because then there will be a third wave of developers that will be mentoring, while the second wave will be developing features, and the first wave will be doing more difficult tasks. As I've told you, this is a growth path. It's not something that is supposed to work for a few days or a few weeks. Is something that as a first objective in 2020, and 2020 is still 8 years away. We have also try to make it easier to submit bugs is still not completely easy. We will improve that in the future. We are doing a lot of automatic tests, which is the reason. At OpenOffice, what was happening was that there was a large number of developers, around 40, and there were 40 people on quality assurance, which is something completely unusual for software. You cannot have as many quality assurance as developers, because it was completely missing all this kind of stuff. So the automatic testing was missing. Now we have started to have automatic testing on different parts of the software, and this is preventing many of the problems to appear on master. So many of the problems are identified and solved before they get into master. So which means before they get into the working development copy of the software. Very short and fast list of new features. These are from every version we added new features. So it's impossible to tell you all. I'm just going through them because we have some of them are small ones. Some of them, for instance, this is Greek characters for bullets. They were missing before. It's probably not a. This is a single feature. It's not a huge one, but of course, for your market, is a key one. And this gives the meaning of what the community is. So that we had probably someone taking care of the Greek alphabet, solving this, which was not a bug, so adding this feature. And we have changed the way calc behaves. There is a new search, color charts, now better HTML export, improved the rendering of text on Linux. We have changed header and footer. This is an example of, let's say, an incremental improvement. Because when we announced this, the fact is that you lose the page limits. You see only, you don't have anymore the, say, the square that shows you the page limit on to make precise positioning of elements. In 3.6 we have added again the page limits for doing precise positioning. So of course we have added a feature. We realized that the feature was interesting but not complete, and then we have completed in one version after. One version after for us means 6 months, because we have a minor version every month and major version every 6. We have switched from a feature-based release plan to a time-based release plan. We release every month. Why? Because we are part of an ecosystem where there is a large number of Linux distribution. And there is, we want the Linux distribution to be able to work in a predictable way with LibreOffice. So Linux distribution know when they will release their next version, and they will most probably be able to integrate the version of LibreOffice that is going to be released on that month, because they can be almost sure that with probably 1 week of delay we will be releasing the version according to our release plan. It's not because we want to stick to the plan just for the sake of sticking to the plan. It's because that plan is a reference for others. And if one feature misses a version, it's going to be solved in less than a month, because the next version is going to be in a month. I can make you an example for 3.6. 3.6, in some cases, doesn't work with orthographical correction. Actually, you have to erase your configuration directory, and then it recreates and it works. But to avoid the workaround, 3.6 has introduced a regression, 3.6.1, and 3.6 was announced on August 8th. 3.6.1, which will be announced at the end of this month, has already corrected this regression. So it's a matter, in this case, of 3 weeks to solve a problem. And this is the reason why we have a time-based release plan, because this allows other people to be to make predictable or to stick to their plans according to our plan. So, for instance, Ubuntu will announce the 12.10 in October, and they already know that they will be able to ship 3.6.3 with their 12.10, because that version will be at the end of October, and they have one person, Björn Mikkelsen, working to integrate LibreOffice with Ubuntu at the latest version. So that's the reason why we have a time-based release plan. We have introduced a grammar checker. Of course, this is for a few languages who have an easier grammar. Grammar checker, for instance, for Italian, and I bet that for Greek is similar, it's almost impossible, because we have ancient languages that have a grammar evolving for a couple of thousand years, and the grammar is very complicated and full of exceptions, and the software can not keep with it. But for instance, in English or some other languages, Grammar Checker works and helps people. We have improved inting on some fonts. We have increased the feature on Calc. We have improved the embedding on palettes. This is an improvement to stick with ODF standard. And this is the import filter for visual documents. This again is another interesting story. This import filter was developed in 2011 by a Google Summer of Code student, a Scottish girl called Eilid McAdam. Eilid is so good at developing software that not only she has developed the visual filter for Calc, but she has found a job at a LibreOffice related company, the German-based Lanido, before ending her graduation. So that means that if you show up and do a good job, you can, working on LibreOffice, you actually can find a job even before you are supposed to find a job, like in the case of Eilid. She finished her master after she found a job on with Lanido, and she's now working, she's quite a brilliant developer, she's now working at migrating our build system to GNU/Make to make it easier and more predictable, the build system, especially on Windows, being in a Linux user group, it's easy to say that Windows, unfortunately, is the operating system that creates more problems, but unfortunately, it's also the most used operating system, and we have to cope with Windows. Microsoft will never recognize that the problems are of Windows, so the problems are always of the other party, and we have, unfortunately, to solve their problems in many cases. So this is the story for the visual input filter. Now for 3.6 we have CorelDRAW, and another Google Summer of Code student is working at the Microsoft Publisher import filter. The reason why we are adding these import filters is because we want to be part of a corporate environment, and on a corporate environment it's important to import Visual, to import Publisher, to import CorelDRAW, because these are the software that are considered a reference in many cases in corporate environment based on Windows. And if we want to be able to migrate those companies from proprietary software to free software, we have to be able to allow these companies to make a sense of all the documents that they have created with the proprietary software before they migrate to free software. We have improved the toolbars. This is very important for people like me that write a lot. Now you can word and characters count is real time. Before you had to open a window and see how many, but it was not increasing while you were typing. New color picker, this is another important feature. Shapes which are automated in Microsoft Office are extremely complicated to import because they are they use a kind of proprietary library. Now we have improved that, and it's been improved more with 3.6. Before it was just a mess. When you imported this stuff, it was not visible, it was not readable. Then we have worked at importing RTF. RTF, unfortunately, is considered a standard format. It's not a standard at all, like many Microsoft so-called standards, because it's a standard with more variables than, than the Italian language. So it's, standards should be, they must be easy to understand, easy to reproduce, and be predictable. Unfortunately, the standards worked by Microsoft are usually difficult to reproduce, difficult to understand, and totally unpredictable. And but we have to cope with them. So we have improved the importing of RTF because, unfortunately, many companies believing in Microsoft Word have used RTF as a standard exchange format, which is not, we don't suggest it, but anyway. 3.6, better spacing on paragraph. This is unfortunately another stuff that is due to the way that Word handles paragraph spacing. Business card and label wizard, which is now working. It was not working before. Better CSV export. Better sorting. These are calc improvement. This is the Corel import filter. Of course, the import filter for graphic formats. Importing to DRAW. DRAW is a very important component of LibreOffice. Many people do not give DRAW enough importance. For instance, many people that look at Impress and compare Impress with PowerPoint, they say that Impress has less features than PowerPoint. They should look at the combination between Impress and DRAW to judge the features, because if you use DRAW, you can emulate most of the features of the drawing feature of PowerPoint. And exchanging the data between DRAW and Impress is very easy, and you maintain all the features of the imported drawing when importing from DRAW into Impress. So if you've never used LibreOffice or you've never use drawing combination with impress, I invite you to use them, because you can do a lot of stuff that in impress is not doable, but with a combination it's easy to do. Watermark in PDF, this is very important, for instance, for legal, for some legal purposes, where you have to write draft or version 1, version 2 as a watermark in the document, which was not possible before. Better rulers, especially on Windows, this is Linux screenshot, so you don't see that as much as you see in Windows. And how we will be in the future. So first we believe to this nice sentence that the future belongs to the few of us that wants to get their hands dirty. So of course, if you want LibreOffice to do something, the best thing you can do is to get your hands dirty with LibreOffice. If you're not a developer, of course, you cannot develop the feature, but just write an email and saying why you don't develop that, this and that, will not convince any developer to develop that feature. For instance, localizing, helping localization in Greek of LibreOffice, and then you write a developer that has already seen your name on the localization list, he will listen to you. Developers are funny people. I like them very much, but they have their own ethos, they have their own philosophy. They are a self-governing group. They are fantastic in a sense. They are crazy to work with in another sense. It's a lot of fun. But if you don't get your hands dirty with the software, in a sense, in what they think it is important, and it might be important just to help other people to make use of the software in a constructive way, a developer will never listen to you. I'm not a developer, I'm a marketing guy. I do many things that developers do not like, for instance, like sending documents to developers that you should never do. But you, and Lionel, that I said before, is a very senior base developer. The first time that I shared a document with the developers, Lionel answered me and said, why are you attaching a document? And Michael Mix very gently sent him an email just before I was answering, said, you have to bear with me, I cannot write, I'm able only to write documents, not code. But Michael Mix, who's a very senior developer, one of the leaders, said, Lionel, Italo can send whatever he wants on our mailing lists. He can send the documents, 20 megabytes, you open it and you answer it educately, gently. Because we don't want to make it all upset, and Michael knows me, and you know I'm old Italian, so I can get upset very soon and very badly, because I have all the defects of the Italians, and let's say all the defects mature for 58 years, so that means that I'm really a bad guy if I want to be a bad guy. I'm a nice guy usually. So the Document Foundation, we want to follow the way that people work with documents. So this is the reason why we have called the organization the Document Foundation. We are working already at this, so this is not just a wishful thinking. This is something we have been working at developing it, and this is something that you will see in the future. This is something that without an independent project that is not connected to any server provider to have their own flavor of the cloud. Because it's easy to say the cloud version should work on every browser. Yes, But guess why Microsoft Office 364 works well with Internet Explorer? There might be a reason for that. Or why it's, let's say, it might be optimized for Spark microprocessors. We don't want to be the independence. The beauty of independence is that we want to build a neutral product. So this is going to be first on Android because the port is easier, but then it's going to be on iOS because we want to be where the users are. It's not a philosophical battle. It's something to solve the problem of the users. And we think that only an independent foundation can do that. Because if you have not an interest in that, there will be another user that has an interest in being neutral. Of course, SUSE guy are working to optimize LibreOffice with SUSE, but Red Hat are working to optimize with Fedora, and Canonical is working to optimize it with Ubuntu. So at the end, the result is that the way LibreOffice works with Linux distros is good for every distro, because there's not a specific interest of having it in a better for one. What we are very convinced and very proud of is to support ODF format. We know that, let's say, the battle between ODF and Office OpenXML is a long one. Microsoft has a lot of money to support their battle, but the reality is that even Microsoft has to give up a little bit every now and then. So at the end, after almost 5 years, they've just announced that they will support ODF 1.2 with their next version of Office, and they will eventually support Office OpenXML strict, because they didn't never support, you know, that Office OpenXML strict means basically that they will be eventually compatible with the Gregorian calendar that everyone is recognizing, even Chinese and Arab people, but not Microsoft, because there is the leap year bug, so Excel is not compatible with our calendar, very simply, which is funny. Sometimes when I tell these people, just falls on the ground, but this is the reality. Of course, it's not compatible in some cases, but the fact is that it's not compatible. We support standards, and we will always support standards. So we have just become member of OASIS. We have an active member. We are an active member of OASIS. We have already several people in their committees. We will contribute in the development of standards. This is going to be based on HTML5, GTK plus 3 Broadway, which is still under development, but is quite stable now. LibreOffice on Path is even more than already compiling. We already have a mock-up of the interface for Writer. Of course, we are shy about announcing it too early, because Android is still evolving and stabilizing, is still not completely stable on new version, and especially when you look at this kind of complex software, the end user interface is not, there's still quite a lot of work to do, because a menu-based end user interface is not good for touch. And you have to make compromises. We are not totally happy about the kind of solution that Apple has found for their iPad version of their iWork suite. Certification, it's going to start in next year. It's something that is intended, and this should be clear, is intended to help third parties to make money with LibreOffice, because we feel that if we help third parties to make money with LibreOffice, they will help the growth of the project. They might be they might decide to give us some money. They might decide to sponsor some development. They might decide to support us in different ways. But we are almost sure that they will decide to support us and to grow the software. There will be a certification track at the LibreOffice conference in Berlin, which is in October. We will start with members in 2012 and third parties in 2013. Sometimes you might think that we are progressing slowly, but you should always think that this is a community-based project, and a community-based project does not make progress because one manager comes in and decides for the others. We must find an agreement and we must find consensus between the different parties, because we want to avoid the situation of Microsoft where they all have to have the same window on that. So, as I've told before, the first target is 2020, and our journey has just begun. So if you want to join, we'd be very happy for you to join. If you drop me an email, my email is there. I will answer. Don't expect that I will answer immediately sometimes, because I'm a volunteer. I have a job that pays my bill, and most of the work that I do for the foundation is evening and weekends. So I might answer immediately, I might not answer immediately, but be sure that I will never ignore any of your emails. If you have any question, I'm happy to answer. I probably talk too much. I finish. Two questions. First one or second one?
Can I ask you, what we all know, that there are some components in LibreOffice that work with the Java Java library. Is there any thoughts of perhaps abandoning that along the way? And what is the current trend for this?
So the dropping Java is one of the objectives. It's probably difficult to drop Java completely because Java has been built into some of the components. I think that in 3.7 we will probably get rid of the warning window says you don't have Java installed, you should install Java before running LibreOffice. So LibreOffice will run even if you don't have selected a Java version, and will not send any warning message. But some feature, for instance Base, is almost impossible to run without Java at the moment. And I think that replacing Java for some of the methods in Base is going to be quite difficult. But let's say that with 4, Java is not going to be compulsory anymore. With let's say 3.7, no warnings, LibreOffice 4, no Java installed, and probably most feature available without Java.
In Android, I use OpenOffice. Or we know that OpenOffice is a fork of make fork. Okay, why don't use this platform to build LibreOffice?
No, there's not an OpenOffice on Android. There are third-party products that read the OpenOffice format, and they read the LibreOffice format as well, because the format is
the same OpenOffice.
The format is ODF, is the same. So you can open the ODF documents with any OpenOffice or LibreOffice reader. That's not a problem. The fact is that what is called OpenOffice on Android is not a native OpenOffice suite, it's a format reader. So you can use, for instance, there is an IBM Symfony format reader. You can use IBM Symfony format reader to open LibreOffice files. So that's, you know, the beauty of the standard formats is this, that you can use any reader to read a standard format. But we don't think about a reader, we think about a full feature product. So it's not just a format reader. Format reader is easy, it's done by third parties, they're mostly based on Java, but we don't care. I mean, reading the format, then at that time you can just save in PDF, and you can, PDF is even better because PDF is stable and it's more transparent than ODF in terms of reading, because it will read your fonts as well. While still ODF does not embed fonts, and therefore if you don't have the fonts installed, you can have some funny results. But if you have, so on formats, let's say, we don't care a lot because there are third-party readers and there is PDF as a solution, which is a good solution. We think about a full suite, full product, with some feature not available because Android is not supporting them. So limitation set by the platform, not by the fact that it's on a tab. It's going to be editable, so at least Writer, Calc, and Impress, and Draw have to work almost 100%. Base may not run, but of course a tablet, it's difficult to consider a tablet a platform for database. Math and may have some problems because Android has not been thought for representing, say, complex character set, but the base product have to work without problems. So it's a full, when we talk about a software, it's the same software working on another platform. So even on a cloud is the same software. Means that you can edit a type table online, save the document and find exactly the same table, same features on your desktop and vice versa. Please.
Can I ask you something? When LibreOffice is going to be used in Android or iOS or in cloud, is there going to be a future that will allow it to save the documents online? It will be LibreOffice will have servers, or you are going to use an application like Dropbox or Ubuntu One to store the files there in order for the users to find them?
So the cloud version, we are not at the moment, then the future we don't know, but at the moment we don't think that we will provide the cloud version as Google Docs provide the cloud version. We will provide the cloud version for companies to install it on their private clouds. Because on the public cloud, then you need a server infrastructure, which is almost impossible to emulate. I mean, there is already, if you want a cloud version, you have already Google Docs. For that kind of low-level edits, Google Docs is already a good one, good solution. So there's no point in offering the same solution. But what we see is the private cloud of a company or a, for instance, Région Île-de-France, which is the administration of Paris, they want to offer the cloud version to the students. So they will have a private cloud provided by their, let's say, Ministry of Culture, where the students will access with their own username and password, and they will use the software instead of using their desktop, they will access the software from the school, from the house. So that is the solution that we see at the moment. Then who knows, you know, it depends, because it's impossible to tell you. I've said that our objective is 2020, but we still don't know what we will use in 2015, so figure out what we will use in 2020. Any other question? Oh, sorry.
How it is decided which feature will be included in which version, or if it will be included at all?
So feature is, again, you have to work with developers. There is not a specific roadmap because at the moment we don't think that there are significant features missing. Of course, there might be features coming out which are made possible by new processor or new platforms. But telling you that there will be features like you know, the smart art in PowerPoint probably doesn't make sense to spend a couple of years of a couple of senior developers to develop something that can easily be done with Draw and imported into Impress. So if you look at the overall features of LibreOffice and Microsoft Office, they probably share more than 90% of the features. So developing new features in an area which has been considered as a mature one, even by Microsoft, if you look at their next version, it's mostly a different interface, it's not more features, just because the features are even too many for the normal user. So at the moment, we don't have a wish list for features. But of course, if some users think that there is a feature which is important, is what I've told you before, just show to the developers that you care about the project and the developer will listen to you. If you just do like some people are doing, like, why you don't, it would be very nice to have to open the document in two separate windows. Yes, it would be very nice, but it takes, because of the architecture, it would take an awful amount of time. So if you just tell it and you are alone, it's difficult to think that the developers will listen to you. Of course, if you start working on it and you show that you care about it, and maybe some developer can start listening to you. It's, you know, pros and cons of a community project.
The Apache Foundation has announced OpenOffice 3.4.
Yes.
Are there any kind of talks between the TDF and the Apache Foundation about on this matter?
Let's say that I would really prefer not to talk about the Apache Foundation first. And if you read the blog of Rob Weil and what Rob Weil writes about us, you can understand the position from when they start. Someone that tells me that I'm an idiot, I'm willing to talk with him, but before he has to ask me, Italian, old and nasty. So he has to convince me that the idiot that has appeared in his messages was, you know, a big mistake. But this is the attitude. The attitude is that we are the people that have destroyed Oracle and so on. It's not constructive, sorry. So we are not going, we are talking with them, they are not listening.
Do we have any picture of the geographical distribution of the developers along the nations, along the countries?
So development is mostly, it was mostly based in Europe. Let's say we started with a mostly European-based development. Now it's going around. Of the 500, probably we still have 50% is European, and the rest comes from the rest of the world. But in Brazil, there is a project sponsored by Itaipu. Itaipu is the biggest electrical company in Brazil. They are sponsoring because they want to have their own version. They want to build their own version. They have created a software development center, and they will have 10 people paid to develop LibreOffice in Brazil. In probably a couple of weeks, we are going to announce a project sponsored by the Kingdom of Arabia, where they have 10 developers working on the Arab version of LibreOffice to improve the Arab version. But you can understand that if they improve the Arab version, they improve the entire product, because if there are bugs affecting the Arab version, then they improve the entire product. So this is what is happening. Of course, the heritage is European, but now it's going around the world. We have, before there was no developers based in the United States. Now we have 10% of the developers based in the United States. It still not represents the way that software is developed, but at least it's a presence there, while before there was really no one. So it's becoming more global with time. Of course, it takes time, and being a difficult code to cope with, developers need some time before they really start to be productive on the code.
Are there any third-party professional support companies in Italy or in Greece?
For
helping out with companies?
There are. This is what we want to make official with the certification project. So we already know many of these companies. There are in Italy, there are in France, there are in Germany, there are in Spain, in Brazil. What has happened so far is that they have not been recognized and they have not been, let's say, certified in a sense that we make sure that they follow the proper process to teach LibreOffice, to support LibreOffice, and so on. So the objective of the certification project is to recognize these companies and help these companies to grow together with the project. So give them an early notice on new features. So if you develop training, of course, if you know the new features before, you can develop the training before. So when the software is out, your training is already ready. If you are writing documentation, if you know the new features in advance, then you are. Your documentation, your manuals will be ready when the software is out. It's not easy because we have a global market, and as I said before, we are going slowly because we want to have that everyone is happy around the project. And there is always the fear that you will give precedence to someone. So we want to have consensus on what we do. And this is the reason why certification, it took almost 1 year to graduate, because we didn't want to make anyone upset. Convincing the developers, for instance, was difficult, because developers, they only trust developers. So at the end, we decided that developers will certify developers. So if to be certified developers, either you are the core developers are happy with you, or you will never be certified. And this is a compromise, of course. But the developers then have accepted that support developers, they will have to train and mentor support level 2 support developers, because this is important for the project. While level 3 is going to be their business, so if you have to develop a patch, either you are a developer or there's no way. So it takes time. Unfortunately, it takes time. There's no one that wakes up in the morning and sends out an email and says, I have decided, because this is not the way that the project can work. But is the reaching consensus is the way that the project can grow together. So even the reason why I'm here today is that I'm happy to meet you, because I think that we can do something positive together. maybe you all will decide to become part of the project, or only one of you will decide. I don't mind. But this is what makes free software an exciting project. I have fun in doing this. If I don't have fun, is the money that pays my time. And I think that this, and of course, this is the work that I will do when I retire. But I still have time to retire. But you know, having fun with friends is something that has no value. Which value can you make to a new friend? You know, it's just priceless. So that's why I'm doing, why I hope you are working in the community for more or less the same principle. Then, of course, each one of us has his own motivation. But what I think is nice is that at the end, we are all here at 8 o'clock in the evening to discuss something that other people might find completely weird. So it's maybe even later than 8 o'clock.
I wish to officially thank Italo for having dedicated quite a lot of his personal time. I have to say that he's here on vacation, so it's not a common thing for anybody to dedicate time from vacation to talk about these weird things, called weird or without quotes. I think we are all very happy to have you. We wish to thank you officially from the Greek Club for dedicating your time and expertise with
you. Yeah, it was a pleasure.